Now is the time to try the Verve Combo Pack for free, where you can get access to several different channels within Verve, including now Nick Splatt, and new episodes get uploaded every month or so of all your favorite classic shows, shows like Rocket Power, Rocco's Modern Life, The Angry Beavers, Doug, Our Real Monsters, and those are just the Nicktoons. You've also got the live action shows like Legend of the Hidden Temple, All That, and Kenan and Kel, all available on Verve, plus several other channels. There's anime on here, there's movies on here, horror movies, and now High Dive is coming to Verve. So, tons of stuff. Try it out for free. The link is down below. Kohei Horikoshi's My Hero Academia is a series that in many ways personifies the phrase right place, right time. And although I feel like My Hero Academia, if it were released at any time, would probably find a measure of success, the fact that Horikoshi's manga and the anime adaptation that soon followed were released smack dab in the middle of the superhero craze that has consumed the United States as well as Japan and, dare I say, the entire world, the timing of this series taking off is no accident. However, one has to wonder if Horikoshi intended it to be this way. 2 years before My Hero Academia would begin publication, Kohei Horikoshi's main manga was known as Sensei no Baraju, Barrage on the Battle Star, and it was released May 21st, 2012. Now, the reason why that date is such an eyebrow-raising date is when you think about what came out in May of 2012. The biggest movie of all time at the time and for several years after would be the very first Avengers film, which was released in May of 2012 and went on to score $1.5 billion at the box office. 2 years later, on July 7, 2014, publication for My Hero Academia would begin in Weekly Shonen Jump Comics. Now, I'm not saying that Avengers was directly responsible for Kohei Horikoshi creating the series, nor am I saying that he saw dollar signs when the numbers came in for the film and that it was a calculated corporate move for him to create the series, because I don't really believe that. But you have to admit that the timing was impeccable. And the reality is that Horikoshi seems to be a pretty smart guy with very good instincts as far as what people want and a very good idea of where the shonen genre may be headed in the near future. And we're going to delve into what Horikoshi did with his characters in My Hero Academia from the very beginning of the manga to connect with so many readers at such a quick pace. But putting aside Horikoshi's business acumen, you can't deny the man is a legitimate fan of superheroes. He said it in interviews in the past that he loves Superior Spider-Man as well as several Western comics, going so far as to say that he'll have a Western comic in his left hand and be drawing in his right, which of course is probably figurative, but still, it shows the connection there. But the fact is, the connection goes back even before 2012. In 2008, Kohei Horikoshi published a one-shot manga called My Hero no Academia, which was the predecessor or the foundation for what would become My Hero Academia. There are very slight similarities between the original story and My Hero Academia, but what's interesting to me is that it was released in 2008, the same year that Iron Man 1 came out, which is the first official film in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Even though it's just a coincidence, I still find it to be another example of interesting synchronicity between the rise of superheroes in the mainstream media and My Hero Academia. But what I think really helped popularize My Hero Academia, right place, right time, with of course the superhero craze, was the incredible anime adaptation, which to me stands out as a glimpse of what may be the future of shonen anime. Now, what do I mean by the future of shonen anime? A lot of people who have become hardcore My Hero fans have told me before I even started watching the anime that it would end up being one of the great all-time series if Horikoshi could continue to produce a great storyline. And to me, that is very high praise, and I am a bit skeptical, but after watching season one of My Hero Academia, I quickly learned that there's a lot of things that it does right, and it's not all just Horikoshi's doing. But if we look at the past of shonen anime adaptations, you can see that My Hero does something different while retaining its sense of familiarity. Now, the easiest contemporary comparison you can make to My Hero Academia is One Punch Man. These two series mirror each other in many ways. Both have a very similar setting in a futuristic world where superheroes and supervillains are both known to the public, praised and despised, and we have very public conflicts between the good guys and the bad guys happening in broad daylight, and nobody even attempts to cover it up. Both series feature a hero academy, with of course My Hero being named after one, where superheroes can test themselves and train with other heroes to become better at what they do, taking the old Xavier School for the Gifted Youngsters trope and turning it into something very, very manga-esque. In addition to that, I also feel like both series don't take themselves too seriously. In a way, My Hero Academia is a satire of modern superheroes, just like how One Punch Man is a satire of both classic and modern superheroes, as well as manga for many, many decades. Both shows have tons of Easter eggs and homages to other fictional franchises. And regardless of how much you may get into My Hero Academia's story, it is undeniable, whether it be beneath the surface or sometimes even on the surface, that you're not supposed to take My Hero Academia that seriously. Kohei Horikoshi wrote it to be fun. It's a fun series. It's an adventurous series. It's one that borrows a lot of the same spirit of the classic shonen shows like Dragon Ball, like Yu Yu Hakusho, and even before that, Fist of the North Star. And while I personally do categorize One Punch Man as being a comedy shonen series, I don't think My Hero's a comedy, but its satirical elements are undeniable. I mean, you've got a group of villains called the League of Villains. You're not going to call something a wispy mustache title like the League of Villains, which was pulled right out of 1955, if it wasn't meant to be funny. I personally like both My Hero Academia and One Punch Man, but I think where the series really differ is in its portrayal of its main characters. We have Saitama over on One Punch Man, who is a superhero that is bored because he wins fights too easily and nothing really challenges him. He's always looking for more of a thrill, but he never seems to get it. So he's there to parody these overpowered superhero good guy manga protagonists that we've seen for so many years that just never seem to lose a fight. Now, when it comes to My Hero Academia, Kohei Horikoshi goes in the complete opposite direction. And to me, this is where I can tell that he knows what he's doing when it comes to writing the main character. Izuku Midoriya, and I'm not going to sugarcoat this, is a fanboy. That's what he is in its purest essence. Izuku Midoriya wants to be a superhero. He is a lovable loser who worships, for lack of a better term, All Might, who is the most famous superhero in the world of My Hero Academia. So one day, he ends up meeting his hero, All Might, and they form a friendship, which ends up being the core element of this story that all the other characters sort of are written around. It's all about Izuku and All Might, at least in the early parts of My Hero. Now, Izuku quickly realizes that All Might is not what he thought. It sort of goes back to that whole idea of when you meet your hero, you realize he's not what you originally thought, but he still is an inspiration to Izuku, and the story ends up sort of transitioning into a coming-of-age story where Izuku has to find not only his courage, but his place not only in the world among other heroes, but also in the eyes of All Might, the guy who he idol worships. Now, the reason why this works so well is because having a protagonist that is not only a lovable loser, but also a fanboy is relatable to a lot of people who are comic book fans, because comic book fans grow up being fanboys, and some retain their fanboyism even until their 20s, 30s, 40s, and so on. And I am by no means saying that all comic book fans are lovable losers, but I am saying that the idea of putting your heroes on a pedestal, so to speak, is one that is rooted back to our childhoods as we grew up being fans of various fictional works. There is a reason as to why so many people were angry at Luke Skywalker's portrayal in The Last Jedi, and it all goes back to this instinctual sort of inner spirit that we have to be inspired. you can't screw around with certain characters. That's why fanboys always rage when movie adaptations fail to properly adapt the character they all grew up with. And I think a lot of us as kids dreamed of being a sidekick or an ally to our favorite superheroes, and this is a reality for Izuku very early on in My Hero Academia. So we're sort of living vicariously through Izuku's successes and failures. And if you have a main character that's either really cool or really relatable or both, you've got a winner of a series. Plus, you've got superheroes, you've got great action scenes and great fights in the manga. It's really a formula for success. And I think another huge reason as to why My Hero is such a major player now is because of the anime adaptation. We've been doing comparisons to One Punch Man, and one thing that's unquestionable is the quality of the My Hero Academia and One Punch Man anime. The primary person who should be praised for the anime version of My Hero being so easy to watch and so likable is producer Wakana Okamura, who knew from the beginning that this series had potential and strived to make it the best it could possibly be. And when you watch My Hero Academia for the first time, you instantly see that it has high caliber animation, but also extremely eye-pleasing visuals as far as character designs go. And My Hero looks and feels fresh and new and different than any other anime out there. Director Kenji Nagasaki and his staff of animators wanted to make the series special, and one of the things they were able to do that other shonen series had problems with is create a solid and workable production schedule. Various long-running shonen series always tend to fall apart when it comes to production. Dragon Ball Super, the series that I am most known for covering, had tons of production problems from the beginning, which is why we had the collapse of the production happen in Dragon Ball Super Episode 5 and other episodes where the animation was subpar. It all happened because Dragon Ball Super was rushed into production and there just weren't enough quality animators at the time who were available to work on the series on such short notice. But luckily, as the series progressed, it got better. Other long-running shonen manga have your bad weeks and good weeks, and what some have also done is, rather than adapt the manga as close as possible, they have tons and tons and tons of filler, which is another thing that gets heavily criticized by anime and manga fans. My Hero Academia and One Punch Man both avoid these problems by having two very key elements. Number one, a passionate staff that really loves what they do and loves adapting these pieces of work into animation. And number two, a non-chaotic production schedule. And they really do go hand in hand. You've got animators that love what they do, being given plenty of time and plenty of creative freedom to do what they do. And that's why My Hero looks like it does, with its really fun, incredible fight scenes and overly detailed character expressions. And one of the main reasons as to why the anime staff was given so much time is because they only have a finite number of episodes to produce per season. And thus, unlike Dragon Ball Super and One Piece that go on and on and on, with My Hero Academia, although the manga is a continuing story published pretty much every week in Shonen Jump, with the exception of a couple of breaks here and there, it's every week you get a new chapter, the anime divides up the story into seasons, and thus it gives the anime staff breathing room and more time to plan things out, and that's why the quality is so much better. At one time, I wondered if Dragon Ball should and could go to a seasonal format. I wasn't sure if it would work with the non-hardcore casual anime fandom, but now looking at things and the way that My Hero is getting bigger and bigger and bigger, I do believe that perhaps other shonen shows could adapt this formula and wind up having better quality overall. But it also will take a number of very talented and driven individuals to really make it work out the way that we all want it to. So even though he wasn't involved in the original manga, people like Yoshihiko Umakoshi should be praised for being the leader of this whole thing. He is the chief animation supervisor and character designer for the anime, and his hands are all over this project. His use of deep shading and vibrant colors give My Hero Academia a very unique look, and one that's very easy to look at on a big screen or even on your smartphone. But what I respect most about the man is he doesn't try to incorporate his own style into everything like other people in the business have tried to do. He is a guy who looks at every original manga and adapts it appropriately and makes sure that the characters look as close as they can to the original work, and he succeeds here in My Hero. And that's why so many people who like the anime went ahead and started reading the manga as well. And also, his tireless work ethic should never be ignored. This man actually makes corrections and improvements to animation for the Blu-ray release after the TV version is already out. Not a lot of shows do this or do it to this frequency. And yet My Hero Academia succeeds because you have a staff that cares about what they do. So you have a winning formula here with My Hero Academia. You have a character who is very easily relatable by fanboys and people who were fanboys at one time in Izuku. You've got the bigger brother sort of dynamic going on with All Might. You've got a top quality animated television show, which is so vibrant and so enthusiastically animated that anybody from a mature anime longtime fan to a little kid can start watching the show and instantly feel a connection to it, as well as a writer, Kohei Horikoshi, who definitely has his finger on the pulse of the future and really could not have picked a better time to release a manga series about superheroes, fanboys, and fanboys who want to and eventually will become superheroes in a real world where being those things has never been more mainstream. Thank you for watching, and if you want me to do more anime breakdowns and analysis like these, please let me know in the comments, as I would love to explore other shows in this level of detail. And just so you know, I just watched season one of My Hero. I'm about to start season two, so I'm positive I'll have thoughts on that in the future. Have a good one, and I'll catch you down the road.